Thank you for the kind invitation. Actually, I'm not just pleased and honored, but a little bit moved by this invitation that there are, in my home country, people who are still interested in my views on specific issues, and especially an institution or institutions, the organizers, whom I truly, truly admire their work in a stress condition. They are doing their job excellently. Since I was warned to speak only 15 minutes and I wanted to make a 15 minutes introduction before my speech, so let me start with a 2 minute introduction. First of all, I'm very sorry to be late. I just arrived from the airport because my flight was late yesterday from Florence to Frankfurt. And actually, I was thinking during my flight today that it is a kind of irony of the fate. I do not dare to say fatelessness, but fate, that someone who has lived for 60 years in this very, very city and left 8 years ago, the city, is late because of the flight. So this reminds me some issues which are really moving for me. I do not want to be too sentimental here. But in the last 8 years since I left this country, on the very week when the late Ronald Dworkin gave a lecture at the almost late Central European University about democracy, he was talking about the hypothetical possibility of dismantling democracy. And at the end of the lecture, it was clear, it was in 2011, that he was talking about Hungary. So in these last 8 years since I left, there were not that many moments I could be proud of my home country. There were three moments. I happened to hear András Schiff, the great pianist, last year in Florence, and two other occasions. He also declared, as you may know, not to enter Hungary until this system of backsliding or dismantling of democracy is present here. My second proud, I already announced, are those human rights institutions who are partly organizers of this conference and a couple of others who are working in a very, very tense environment and still doing a great job. And the third is Prezi, which I want to use as my presentation, a Hungarian invention. Okay, that was the 2 minutes, probably more. So let me start and let me skip some issues. Here is the oversight of everything I won't be talking about. The signs of backsliding in East Central Europe, especially in Poland and Hungary, where this kind of dismantlement of judicial independence is a hot topic. Then about the oversight in two steps or probably in three possible third step. So the traditional mechanisms of infringement procedure and Article 7 against those countries, especially Poland and Hungary, who among other things, also dismantling judicial independence. Then very shortly about the rule of law framework introduced in 2014 and used first against Poland. And finally, before concluding, a new possibility which is in the horizon now to use financial sanctions. In other words, making rule of law conditions to EU funds. Okay, let's start. And so, without going into details, what I'm talking about in these two countries, but unfortunately, as you may have heard the news from Romania about the judiciary, the problems of the judiciary recently in Romania or even Bulgaria, or we can talk about Slovakia as well. So in this region, this illiberal agenda, as the Hungarian Prime Minister used to characterize this authoritarian pursuit, this illiberal agenda is twofold. One is the lack of checks and balances, especially dismantling constitutional review, the constitutional court, but also threatening or even dismantling the independence of the ordinary judiciary. The second characteristic of this illiberal agenda is the lack or at least the threatening of fundamental right guarantees, which also relates to the first one, the lack of judicial review or the lack of independence of the courts, but it has also substantial issues, the lack of freedom of the media, lack of freedom of religion in the case of Hungary, and I may mention other issues. As I already mentioned, the two main countries are Poland and Hungary, discussed here with one very, very important difference. Then in Hungary, the government has the two-third majority, which entitles them or entitled them to make a brand new constitution, while in Poland, the governing party does not have this two-third majority, which means that they every day have to violate their own constitution, which is not the case in Hungary, because it's easy not to violate this already illiberal constitution. The relationship to the EU is also very, very characteristic in both countries. And the last characteristic is the substantial support of the EU, which will lead me to the, at the end, to some conclusions and possible new toolkits of the European Union. Here is a story of the silencing of judicial review, the constitutional courts. Actually, very interestingly, in both countries, this was the first step of a playbook, how to let democracy die, as a recent book says. The Hungarian participants already know the story and read this playbook in the very beginning of 2010, curtailing the competences of the court, then packing the court with loyal justices. Actually, the same happened in Poland after peace came to power in late 2015. The first thing was packing the that time independent constitutional court. Okay, very, very shortly about the traditional mechanism, without listing all of them here, you see what happened in the case of Hungary, actually starting in a very, very interesting case related to the judiciary on the early retirement age of the judges case, which actually went as far as to the European Court of Justice, which actually ruled against Hungary in its judgment in 2012, stating that Hungary violated the age discrimination directive of the EU. Actually, none of those judges who were sent into retirement were reinstated into their own previous positions. Some of them were reintroduced as judges, but none of them in their position, which means they were mostly, due to their age, leaders of certain kind of courts, court presidents. None of them get back their job as court president. So the mission was accomplished, despite the fact that the European Court of Justice ruled against Hungary. The Hungarian government was able to change the personnel of the entire judiciary, meaning the leading personnel, and step by step the entire personnel. I do not go into the other measures taken by the European institutions. Actually, the so-called rule of law framework was designed against Hungary, then was not used against Hungary, but first against Poland. But the end of the story is last September, when finally the European Parliament triggered an Article 7 procedure against Hungary. Okay, the same story in Poland started 5 years later, starting with the dismantlement of the Constitutional Court first, then the ordinary courts, the Supreme Court, the same playbook story about the retirement age measure against some Supreme Court justices, which is still not solved. Poland was probably less lucky than Hungary, because the rule of law framework was triggered against them, and also Poland was the first, even though starting 5 years later and being far less developed on the road of dismantling liberal democracy altogether. They were the first where Article 7 was triggered in the end of 2007. What is the reason of this difference? I guess it's clearly a political reason. Fidesz, the Hungarian governing party, is part of EPP, the largest party group in the European Parliament, the European People's Party, while PiS, the Polish governing party, is not. Okay. Lastly, so since all those mechanisms, infringement procedures, Article 7, seem to be hopeless in order to force those member states of the European Union to comply with the very values and principles of the European Treaty, especially Article 2. There must be some other ways to force those countries, at least if they want to enjoy these benefits of the European funds. I guess the only solution would be to either suspend or cut those funds altogether. There are two arguments against this approach. One argument is that of course this is a kind of punishment of the people who live in those countries, in Hungary and Poland, because in the case of Hungary, in the last election, it's 49% of the people voted for Fidesz, so the majority of people voted not voted for this government, and still they would be punished by these measures. My counter-argument to this would be that this could be a kind of motivation for those voters who voted for Fidesz to think about whether this is the best government to have. Another argument which goes along the line of those organizations who are partly organizers of this conference, that they will be also punished. There are solutions, and happily I see in the last weeks some directions that the European Union is considering to support those organizations directly and not through those governments. Okay, concluding remarks, partly already explained. Lastly, about the perspectives. So there are two ways before the European Union in the next future. One is the so-called two-speed Europe, announced by many European leaders and announced by the so-called white paper of the Commission. This is acknowledging the split of the European Union between those countries who do comply with the European values and those who do not. I don't think that this is a way forward to abandon those countries, probably cutting their funds and leaving them alone. The second option is much more difficult and needs much more invention how to force those countries to be also compliant with the joint values of the European Union. Thank you very much.
Thank you to the organizer for the invitation. I have just 12, 15 minutes, so I go straight ahead to the point. Well, Italy, in the last 5 years, enjoyed good times for judicial reform and judicial discussion, meaning that the judiciary has not been challenged, the judiciary developed new ideas, it's possible to have open, critical discussion with the judiciary. This has not always been the case. I've been called here because Italy is considered an inspiring case about how to challenge judicial independence based on what happened in Italy in the last 25, more than 30 probably, years, particularly with the government of the center-right coalition preceded by Mr. Berlusconi. So to represent 25 years of political debate and judicial reforms in 15 minutes means to do brutal cherry picking. And I have done cherry picking. I have taken exclusively or mainly the situations in which judicial independence has been challenged in the last 25 years, or the rule of law has been challenged. So I will look more to Berlusconi, much less to the other government, because they didn't do a lot in terms of challenging judicial independence. But before doing this, few words to contextualize the case. First of all, judges and prosecutors are part of a unique professional career in Italy. We call them magistrates, magistrati. And this is not the case in many other countries. We have just one superior council of the magistracy in which judges and prosecutors sit together. Two-thirds of the members are elected by magistrates ex officio, There are some ex officio members, but doesn't change the picture. One-third elected by the parliament. So the majority within the council is always of magistrates. That means self-government. And important for the discussion of today is the constitutional position of the public prosecutor that are not very different from those of judges. So they enjoy very similar guarantee of judicial independence. This is coupled with mandatory criminal action. That means that prosecutors are supposed to investigate any single crime. And until 1992, the organization of public in 1992, when this story starts, public prosecutor enjoyed also very strong individual independence, meaning that the supervisory power of the chief prosecutor on the organization of his own prosecutor office was very, very weak. Other issue that were important is both the absence of performance evaluation of judges and prosecutors that were promoted basically on the basis of seniority and lack of demerit, meaning lack of disciplinary sanctions. And let's start with Berlusconi I. Now you understand also to understand why this information are important. Berlusconi I arrives in 1994 after Mani Pulite, Clean Hands Investigation. Clean Hands Investigation has been a massive, systematic investigation about political corruption in Italy that enjoyed such a strong popular support that has been considered a case of judicial populism. So exactly the contrary we are assisting today. This is not the topic of my presentation. But Berlusconi started supporting with this television Mani Pulite. When he entered into power as prime minister, the first attempt failed has been to appoint the iconic representative of Mani Pulite prosecutorial team, Magistrate Di Pietro, as Minister of Internal Affairs, and Berlusconi lawyers as Minister of Justice. Luckily enough, it didn't succeed. At the beginning, the strategy was quite careful, but immediately, two problems started to jump up. One was the conflict of interest of Berlusconi with his many interest in many areas, television and not only television, and the other one is, let's say, is that prosecutors started to investigate Berlusconi's activities. Here you have a link on Wikipedia in English where you have a list of all the cases brought against Berlusconi. I just made a quick count before. There have been 23 concluded trials in which he got just one conviction and three ongoing procedures. Okay? So if you ask the story to a Berlusconi supporter, they say, well, Berlusconi reacted in the way I will describe you now, because he was constantly under an unfair attack by prosecutors. You remember how prosecutors are independent and can decide what to prosecute. If you ask to the other part, they will give you a different answer. You will take the decision looking at other information. I gave you which one of the two stories is more effective. But this is just a matter of context. What is important for the discussion of today are the strategies used by Berlusconi government in the field. Well, when investigation started, Berlusconi immediately made, and some persons in the Berlusconi entourage were arrested, Berlusconi immediately approved a law decree that, and immediately entered into force, that prohibit pretrial detention in financial crime, white-collar crimes. It was clearly unconstitutional, strong outcry. We called it the first law ad personam. We will see this term many times in a few minutes. He had to retire the law few days later. However, he succeeded because some of Berlusconi, let's say, persons that were already under arrest went out of the jail. Second strategy, inspections. The Ministry of Justice can trigger inspection. The inspectorate is built within the Ministry of Justice, even if the inspector, the chief inspector, and most relevant inspector are magistrates. But he can ask to make inspection, and first started an inspection within the Milan Public Prosecutor Office to check if to ascertain if there are behavior relevant from a disciplinary point of view. And this has been, to me, the first clear attack to judicial independence. 95, after several months, no anomalies found by the inspection board. But there are also reactions on judicial side. And in November 94, when Berlusconi was presiding a United Nations conference on organized crime in Naples, so where you may remember in those years we had the mafia murder of Judge Falcone and Judge Borsellino, so they were very tough here from that point of view, and not just from that point of view. Berlusconi was presiding this conference, and exactly in those days, prosecutor office in Milan summoned him, the fact that he was investigated for corruption, I think. So these two see that there were strikes on both sides. Reaction by the Judicial Council and by the magistracy, very interesting in the perspective of this meeting. Supreme Council of the Magistracy starts what they call pratica tutela. Pratica tutela are statements approved by the council that defend individual judges or courts by external attack or attack against judicial independence. And this is something that has been used regularly to say this behavior is considered by us an attack to judicial independence, and the council declare this and will operate to protect the judge or the prosecutor from this attack. First point. Second, more important, like the first one, they approved the first ethical code. Ethical code was also an answer to try to invite judges and prosecutors to some form of self-restraint. Put it in brutally, with the few information we have, the fact of serving a summon in a UN conference was something that could have been delayed of a few days, with probably better result in terms of soft running of the system. At the end of the story, Berlusconi lost a confidence vote. There is a technical government, a government supported by center-left, but also with the support of Berlusconi, that went on with inspection as way to threaten judicial inspection. The chief prosecutor in Milan reacted at that point, said, well, please tell me which is the scope and mandate of this inspection. And this has been considered by the Ministry of Justice as intimidating in respect to the inspectors, and it triggered a specific disciplinary case against the prosecutor in Milan that has been closed without any result, of course. Going very quickly, this is Prodi's government in the 96, center-left. The first attempt to reform and to assess one of the weaknesses I mentioned at the beginning, the lack of professional evaluation of judges and prosecutors. And here we observed a weakness of the judiciary that reacted too negatively and said, well, this was just to give marks as school pupils to the judges, what called pagelle flick, means that pagelle is what a student receives at the end of the year. And judges reacted against, there's been a quite complicated discussion, but at the end, the Magistrate Association was against this. And so judiciary remained without forms of professional evaluation for other years. And Berlusconi won election again in 2001. And in two times has been government roughly for 5 years. And this has been really the bad time for us, probably the time you are living now. Just a second, yes, I have 5 minutes. Another way to attack the magistracy. The Senate approved a statement that openly criticized a judicial decision against the Prime Minister. So the Parliament started to talk against judges as a whole. And the President of the Senate is the second authority of the state. Berlusconi defense team was made, in most of the cases, by members of the Parliament. And there were standing in front of the judge with a double role, with a double hat, defense lawyers and member of the parliament of the majority. So when it was time to approve a new law ad personam to help Berlusconi in some areas, the law was anticipated by the lawyer in the hearing. Laws ad personam has been, I think, the most powerful weapon used by Berlusconi in this fight. Libertà e Giustizia is a kind of NGO with very high profile management board, so cannot be, certainly they are not supporting Berlusconi, but they cannot be accused of partisanship. Well, they counted 38 leggi ad personam, 38 laws ad personam, between 1994 to 2011 and 33 2001-2011. Two examples, rogatory letters. Italy and Swiss made an agreement to bypass bank secret. Of course, many proofs about corruption were hidden in Switzerland, because the proof was money, the circulation of money, and if you cannot access those information, you cannot prove money transfer. And when the government had to, has to approve the convention, start to build formal complexity that would make impossible the to enforce rogatory letter. Reform of company law. False accounting was not a crime anymore, even big false accounting. Of course, why? Because also in this case, there were accusations against the prime minister of false accounting. Most often, this law were unconstitutional. And the constitutional court ruled against the laws. But in the meanwhile, in the time in which they've been active, they worked to protect the prime minister from the accusation of the prosecutors. And this is the big battle, the landmark reform. In Italian is riforma epocale, the reform that, that marks an era. And it was, in a nutshell, an attempt to redesign the judiciary in a hierarchical way. Three or four apparently small changes. An increased profile of the Ministry of Justice in appointing the head of court and prosecutor office that was just 99% a matter of the Judicial Council of the Magistrates. I cannot enter into the technicalities because it's quite complex. Second, you establish a new system, a compelling system of performance evaluation with the career system, and the court president or the prosecutor, chief prosecutor, has a strong role in this evaluation. Essentially, you build a hierarchy, ideally. A stronger role of the executive in appointing the court president evaluates the judges, and the judges has to act in some way, are pushed to act accordingly to the desiderata of the executive. Of course, it's a loose coupling, but this was the idea I can share with you in a few minutes. This would have also triggered a competitive competition within courts to get the points required for promotion. The evaluation of judges and prosecutors is a very difficult issue, but this was the design. The CMS wrote and approved a critical opinion. Judges and prosecutors went into strike. Regardless of all this, the parliament approved the reform. And the President of the Republic is one of the few times in the history used this power, refused to sign the law for blatant inconstitutionality on different areas. The Parliament made limited formal changes, and at that point the President had to approve the law. This to show you how checks and balances can work. Of course, this affected the political climate. The government managed to transform the legislative, to approve the legislative decree that were implementing the reform, but Berlusconi lost the election. And essentially, the reform had been enforced for a very limited amount of months because the center-left, government to enter into force changed the law. I don't have the time to tell you how, but in a more reasonable way, and reform the judicial system in a way that is, I think, now coherent with international good practices. Berlusconi has been again in power in 2008-2011, and at this point he used the old, well-functioning tool of legge ad personam. Essentially, if you will see the description, I don't want to enter into the detail of lodo Alfano or legittimo impedimento, there were all laws that were suspending trials in which the prime minister was involved for various reasons. So the idea, the goal here was not an attack to judicial independence. It was simply, I don't want to be judged now by you. It was a matter of postponing the decision. There has been, during the year, another way to attack judicial independence, and direct attacks to judges and prosecutors. Here there are two examples. Just look at the link. Unfortunately, everything is in Italian, but it's when you use television to make really artificial accusation about a judge. Judge Mesiano was a judge that ruled against Berlusconi just for the sake of challenging the credibility, the personal credibility and reputation of this person. And Boccassini was the deputy chief prosecutor in Milan, and was accused of making shopping in high-end shops in Milan, buying something in Hermes shop. This was the accusation. So you understand that they are really reaching very low, miserable, I would like to say, level with this kind of behavior. And this is the final weapon, the final, almost the final slide. We can deny justice, as we all know here, impinging the rule of law, challenging or reducing judicial independence. We are not dealing with this issue. We can deny justice, reducing access to justice, as it is happening in Europe in the last few years. But you can also stop the turnover of clerks and for a limited time of judges, as it happened in Italy. So between 2002 to 2017, essentially no one unit of administrative personnel has been recruited by the Ministry of Justice. For 2 years, the turnover has been stopped also for judges and prosecutors, but the result with administrative staff is this. Just look at administrative staff in post. In 2001, we had 45,000 persons working in court, prosecutor offices, and Ministry of Justice. In 2017, 34,000, minus 11,000. When you do this, what happens is very simple. You don't have to change constitution. Simply, you put court in condition not to operate. And if your goal is to delay proceedings in order not to be convicted, well, this is plain and simple. You don't violate any international standard. You have the advantage that there is an economic crisis, that you can argue that you cannot recruit person because there is an economic crisis, but when you look at the big picture, you see that in other sectors there have been recruitment, and in the administrative sector there's been no recruitment at all. And if you come back to the last, I hope this will work, yes, to the last picture, you see the new extraordinary recruitment enacted by the government in the last couple of years. Because if you don't have clerks, it means that the judge have to do also the work of the clerk. It means that justice is delayed and justice is denied. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation to come here and participate in this important and interesting conference. I will go further back in history and tell you some of the results of my own research, which has been into the situation of courts and judges under authoritarian circumstances in Europe during the 20th century. So I'm not talking about the current situation, but I think there are some lessons to be drawn from this. I will briefly address 3 points. My first point is that the rule of law is a cultural phenomenon embedded in history. And with this, I mean also the ancient history going back to the medieval times in Europe. And I will illustrate this by mentioning the paradox of the judicial independence under Nazi Germany and the Nazi system. My second point will be on how the rule of law was attacked and circumvented in countries of this Western legal tradition in the 20th century, and how the judges reacted. And the third point will then bring this up to the current situation and talk about the importance of path dependence for the continuation of this tradition and pose some questions to the current situation in Europe. All this within 15 minutes. I refer you also to my book, which was published some years ago, that addresses these issues, where you can find more about these things. First then, just to bring us back in history, legal historians talk about a Western legal tradition that started in the medieval times. I've here mentioned some important events. Most people, when they talk about the rule of law in medieval times, think about Magna Carta, because the English are very good at marketing their tradition. But this is a common tradition of the Western world, stemming from the conflict between the emperor and the bishop over the investing of and the pope over the investing of bishops, that resulted in the establishment of a secular legal profession and the recognition that also the emperor was bound by law. And this was the beginning of the rule of law as we know it in our Western tradition. The main features of this was that the society and the state should be ruled by law, that the emperor, as I said, is bound by law also, that the authorities must respect the rights of each other, starting with the division of power, which was a legal division between the pope and the emperor, and also the establishment of a feudal system of division of power that was based on law. This does not mean, of course, that we had a rule of law in Europe concurrently through the ages from the 12th century, but these were established as important ideological and cultural phenomena. Also economic historians, they explain the development of the economic success of Western Europe also going back into these basic principles of the rule of law, which is another story then. We see this as a paradox in the Nazi legal order. We all know, of course, that Nazi society, the Nazi state, was a lawless state. But surprisingly, it was also a state that recognized judicial independence and the rule of law in a certain perverted sense by establishing what has been called by the legal and social theorist Ernst Frankl the dual state, which meant that the law and the judicial independence and the independence of law operated in parallel with the state oppression outside of the law. There are no professionals that enjoyed the same sort of independence and protection against persecution as the judges in Germany. Most of the judges were compliant with the system and applied the law in concurrence with the Nazi ideology, but there were some judges that gave rulings that opposed the system. But there were no known instances of judges being subject to the persecution of the Gestapo and the SS and the concentration camps due to their judicial functions. There were, of course, judges who acted politically outside of the bench, which is another matter, but I'm now talking about judges in their judicial function. So in a certain sense, there was a Rechtsstaat in Germany. They defined the Rechtsstaat as a national socialist Rechtsstaat in contrast to the liberal Rechtsstaat, which they saw as a perversion of the German tradition. But it was still a society that, in a way, respected this tradition. So this is a paradox, but it also shows the cultural importance of the historical development. Now, we all know, of course, of the legacy of the breakdown of civilization through the Nazi rule and the development of legal protection and the rule of law through the European institutions in Europe that have institutionalized the rule of law and legal protection and human rights in a very different and more comprehensive manner than we had before this development. We've already been addressing this today. But there are also still challenges to the rule of law and legal protection despite this development of international standards and international institutions. And I think then that the lessons of history can tell us more about these challenges. There are basically, if we look into the historical examples, four ways that the state can circumvent the rule of law without even undermining judicial independence, as we saw in Nazi Germany, as we saw in other countries under fascist and Nazi rule during the 20th century. Basically, there are four ways. One is the unregulated use of force by security forces, totally outside of the control of the state. The most prominent example of this is perhaps Argentina during the military rule, where there were tens of thousands of disappearances by semi-official military forces, and also by the military. The second is the use of administrative force that is sort of part of the state, but outside the jurisdiction of the courts, which is the dual state that existed in Germany, where we had the SS and the security police outside of the jurisdiction of the courts, but subject to their own rules, but that meant that it was not unregulated as such, but it was not controlled by courts or by law in any meaningful way. Then we have the use of force through state-controlled courts, the establishment of military courts, special courts, and so on. That was an important part of oppression in, for example, Brazil, which was a military dictatorship by establishment of also military courts, where much of the oppression took place. And then finally, we have the use of the regular courts by changing the law. We heard examples of this in a different and less sinister setting from Italy just now, but also much of the persecution of the Jews that went before the Holocaust and the extermination, the deprival of the Jews of all civil rights and of legal personality, took place within the regular courts of Germany, based on legal decisions, in many times by reinterpreting law without any specific legislation passed by the executive or legislative bodies. The attacks on the courts have been in many forms. One of the most common types of attacks is by limiting the jurisdiction of the courts, and we see this concurrently in many situations. We also see this today, of course, but this is one of the most common ways of circumventing independent courts, is by limiting the jurisdiction. We see this also in democratic situations by the use of emergency law and by the use of national security as argument. This was an important feature of also Western European countries after World War II, during the Cold War, where the control of communists and political opponents took the form of state discretion that was not controlled in any meaningful sense by the courts. We also have attacks on judicial independence, which we have been talking about already today, so I won't go into detail here. And then we have changes in the substantive law, limiting individual rights and excluding targeted groups from legal protection. Now, how have the judiciary reacted to this type of attacks? Well, unfortunately, when we look into our historical experiences, in many cases, the judges accept this type of attacks, and they subject to this type of rule. In most cases, judges accept limits of their jurisdiction. There are very few examples of judges sustaining an opposition against such limits of jurisdiction when they are enacted by the executive or the legislative bodies. We have some examples of judges initially trying to limit the limitation of the jurisdiction, but these types of counter movements are often often removed after a short time. And in other cases, the judges just subject to such and respect such limits without any type of resistance. The other one is when it comes to attacks on independence. This is where we can see some opposition from the judiciary, where we have some historical examples. I mentioned one here on the slide of the Norwegian Supreme Court in a conflict between the German occupying authorities, upholding their right to review legislation passed by the occupying authority. I could also have mentioned the Belgian judges and the Supreme Court during the German occupation. That is another example. And we also see a very visible example now with the Polish judges opposing the attacks by the Polish government on their independence. When it comes to the third type of attack, in most cases, judges unquestionably apply the law in a positivistic way, disregarding the content of this law. This is also something that is embodied in the rule of law, because of course the law, the rule of law entails that the judge is bound by the law and should not substitute the law for his or her own opinions on politics or ethics or morality. And this puts the judge then in a difficult situation when there's a conflict between the ideals of the rule of law on the one hand and the positive law on the other hand. But in most cases, the judges fall down then on the side of the positive law. An important part of the historical legacy is what social scientists label as path dependence, that institutions and norms and values follow a path that is established. This is because the norms and the values are humanly constructed constraints that shape not only the incentives in a sort of positive way, but they also shape social and economic and political interaction through tacit knowledge and patterns of thought. One of the explanations of the paradox in Germany during the Nazi time was that having law and courts without judicial independence was in a way unthinkable to the German lawyers and the German politicians. So they couldn't really imagine being judges and at the same time not being independent judges, differently from what we saw, for example, in the Soviet Union during the Stalinist time. This brings us up then to the current challenge, the rule of law backsliding that started in 2010 and which you are well familiar with. And I will end then with some questions that in my opinion are important to evaluating the situation in Hungary today. If the rule of law is a cultural phenomenon, and if there is a strong importance of path dependence, well, an important question then is how established is Hungary and the Hungarian society in the Western legal tradition? And what sort of categorizes the Hungarian legal tradition compared to the legal tradition of other countries within Europe? The second question is, to what extent was the authoritarian time of communism a clean break with this tradition of the legal tradition of Hungary? And to what extent was there a continuity in the tradition through this period? And a third question is, bringing in then the experience of the authoritarian time, what are the remnants of a socialist legality or the subject of the law under politics? What are the remnants of this, or are there any remnants of this in the current legal culture of Hungary? And the final one is also to the question of the relationship between national and international law and standards. Is there a consensus or is there a division among Hungarian judges today on the subordination of national law under European law? This is a question which is interesting, I can say then in parenthesis that in my own country, the judiciary is split more or less down the middle on this issue. We see when we have cases in the Supreme Court that more or less half the judges subject the national law to the international standards, whereas half of the judges uphold the national legal standards in these situations. And what's the situation here? Well, I see my time is out, so I will end there. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. These questions are fascinating, and I hope that after the lunch break we will have some responses to them, because that panel is going to be now turning to Hungary, and we'll look at some empirical research that has been carried out and hopefully might address some of the very relevant questions that you've posed. Now, we still have, I think, about 10 minutes for questions, and I hope there will be questions from the audience or maybe some contributions, so you're more than welcome to raise your hand. I see my colleague Dani in the back. Anybody else? Then.
Thank you very much. My question would go to Mr. Contini. And my question is whether the situation you mentioned and described, the attacks on the judiciary, do these attacks have a long-standing impact, or became the judges more strong as a result of these attacks, and they could fight back now, or how is the long-term effect of these attacks on the independence of judiciary?
I can provide my answer, but Judge Michelini can add, of course. I think that the independence of the judiciary was already culturally built in and taken for granted before the story I told you in Italy. Certainly in the 90s, in the 80s, was very strong. I think at the end of the process, judiciary is stronger because some of the vulnerabilities I mentioned at the beginning have been reduced. Now, as I mentioned, the professional evaluation of judges is sound. I would suggest some improvement, but this is a normal dialogue between researchers and the council and the judiciary. So at the end, there's been a big suffering, but I don't see long-term negative consequences. One of the negative consequences, when you have any body exposed to such pressure, is that the body closes himself or as in a protective cocoon. And then for a while it becomes very difficult to have an open, healthy dialogue with the body. And this is a normal defensive routine. It went on for a while, but now I think that also this negative side effect is over. Of course, we are again in Italy in a situation in which populist and anti-system parties are leading the country. So we don't know what will happen in the future. I think the judiciary, however, thanks to the constitutional design of the country, is still quite well protected and will manage to remain independent also in the future.
Yes, Ambassador, please.
Microphone.
Maybe you'd like to come over here and switch.
Yes, for Professor Graver, you spoke about the Norwegian split on the ability or the wish to subject national law to international. How is that perceived in your society? Is that just a fact, or does nobody care about it, or is it part of a discussion? And so, could you elaborate a little bit on that?
Well, you know, Norway has had twice referendums on joining the EU, and the population is split, or was split almost down the middle both times, and both times the opposition won the referendums. And I think this is also part of the explanation of the division among the judges, because this goes both to questions of EU law through the EEA agreement, to which Norway takes part, and also to the European Convention on Human Rights. So I think this just reflects a discussion that we have. It's not very dramatic, because it doesn't mean that the half of the judiciary that wants to uphold national law over European law does not want to uphold standards of protection of rights and so on. It's more a question of principle here.
Thank you. Professor Halmai actually has a question, if you allow this.
I'm sorry for that. It's probably unusual that someone from the panel asks questions from another panelist. But to Professor Graver, I highly enjoyed your presentation. So it's really, I would say that the first part of the presentation, or the entire presentation, I agree 100%, especially with the claim that both rule of law, judicial independence are culturally embedded in a society. But let me react to your three questions by asking the same question regarding Germany. So the first question is the situation in Germany, judicial independence and the rule of law, is a continuation of the Nazi past, where, as you explained in your presentation, the formalistic approach of rule of law, especially by Karl Schmitt, was very much dominating the entire approach to rule of law. The second question, is there any legacy of the Nazi rule in Germany? And the third question, what about the subordination? We all know that the German Bundesverfassungsgericht is the most not subordinated player within Europe. The German Constitutional Court is the one which refuses the kind of absolute primacy of EU law. In other words, this kind of absolute subordination of EU law. So would you put the same question regarding Germany? Thank you.
I think one of the intriguing things about the legal history of Germany through this time was the fact that the judiciary, as a matter of the composition of the personnel, hardly changed through the regime shifts. The Nazis took over the judges of the Weimar time without replacing many of them. And the Federal Republic of Germany took over the Nazi judges without replacing them. So I think this says something about the approach, the cultural approach to the law and the autonomy of law in the German judicial mind. Of course, there were formal changes to the rule of law
when the Nazis took over, and Carl Schmitt was one of them, expressing the role of the Führer as the final judge and the supreme judge. Formerly, Hitler had the power to intervene into any legal proceedings and to overrule any legal decision. But in practice, this was not used to any great extent. Actually, also the Nazi Party was prohibited from intervening into the workings of the judiciary. So it's really, I think, that's why I call it a paradox, because on the other hand, we all know what how the regime was when it comes to respecting any form of rights or legality as we know it. The question of legacy of the Nazi time, I think is, I haven't studied Germany in the current situation, so I might not be the right person to answer that. I think it's a complicated question. I think when it comes to the Nazi ideology, it's difficult to see much of a legacy, but then some people might say that the recent developments in the political situation of Germany might question this opinion. Constitutional court, that was a new institution, established new, and it was recruited differently than the recruitment of judges to the normal judiciary in Germany, and I think that might be part of the explanation of its operation in a way that is quite different from the traditional operation of the German judges.
Thank you. I think we still have one last question. Please. The lady here in the fourth row.
Thank you. I have a question to Francesco. That I was wondering what the prospects can be for the Hungarian judiciary, and do you think that if the judiciary organized itself and realized what its strength is, it's enough, or do they need some support from other external institutions? Because the examples you brought show that there was other institutions, like the Constitutional Court or the President, that intervened and tried to step up and speak up in the interest of the judiciary. So is it, in a context when the judiciary is considered Hungary now, the last relatively autonomous branch of power, and no other institutions can be seen as an independent one. Is it possible only for the judges to protect themselves and resist the attacks?
I cannot answer for the Hungarian situation. Certainly, is much more difficult. What certainly helped, as you noticed, the Italian situation was the checks and balances embedded in the Constitution. So if we take the landmark reform I just briefly sketched out, it was on various aspects clearly unconstitutional. And so my expectation is that also without the change of political party rule in the country, it would have been almost completely challenged and modified by the Constitutional Court. So this, in a way, provides safeguards. I don't know if this kind of safeguards or to what extent this kind of check and balances are working in Hungary, because I don't know enough the system. Certainly, Hungary is not alone, and I think the first panel made clear that there are other venues of evaluation, guidance, and support, and that to some extent, if Hungary aims to stay in the European Union, has to consider some of the pressure or the decision that are coming, for instance, from the court in Luxembourg. So the exercises, the challenge is very hard, but Hungary, I think, is not alone and is in a system in which can find support in different areas, even if it's very difficult. And also, there is a point that is very difficult to understand from abroad, and is what I said at the beginning for the Italian case. So the idea of independence is really taken for granted from a cultural point of view. And with independence, I mean institutional independence, but also internal independence. I mean, to be brutal as indicator, that if a first instance judge have a decision quashed by a superior court, we don't think this as a mistake of the first instance judge. We think this as a different evaluation of the case for various reasons. Just when you enter and we read the decision, we can understand if there was maybe, and it can happen, a wrong interpretation of the law, but it's something that cannot be taken for granted. So if this is embedded in the way in which judges look at the profession, well, it helps. If they think that the superior court is always right, the challenge is even more.